The Great International Education and Schools Fair from Relocate Global and Think Global People is drawing to an end. And I'm delighted to introduce our closing keynote, Chris O'Shaughnessy, on harnessing hope to navigate global uncertainty.
Well, hello there. Thank you so much for joining me. It is such an honor to get to be a part of the Great International Education and Schools Fair. What an incredible wealth of knowledge and experience here. My name is Christopher O'Shaughnessy, and I work as a speaker, comedian, and author with international schools, colleges, universities, militaries, and other organizations to try to help them better support the globally mobile community and make the most of an ever-globalizing world. But you know what? Enough about me. Let's talk about you, because you have a lot to do, so we may as well get started. And what better way to start than with a story? Because stories are fun, and they bring us together. Not to mention, they are one of the most efficient ways that our brains organize and recall concepts. So here we go. For this story, I would like you to imagine a gym. Now I would like you to imagine that gym in medieval times. Now, admittedly, getting people to join a gym in medieval times would probably be a very difficult sell. For one thing, most people actually worked pretty hard physically just to stay alive. If you went and then tried to sell them on a gym and said, "Listen, you can come be part of my gym, let me explain. We have heavy objects that you can lift and then put right back down." Not many medieval people are gonna go for that. Most of them would probably point out that as a manner of just staying alive, they constantly have to lift heavy objects and probably do so because they want to put them somewhere else. The idea of putting them right back down seems incredibly inefficient. And even if you continued on with this amazing new invention called a treadmill, I mean, mills gotta be exciting. They use that to make flour, but no, wait. This mill doesn't produce anything. In fact, on this treadmill, you can run and go nowhere. Again, a very difficult sell. I imagine that most people in medieval times ran because they needed to get somewhere different. They were either running away from or towards something. The idea of running to go nowhere would seem ridiculous. In short, opening a gym would be incredibly difficult in medieval times. And yet, we have loads of gyms now. That's because between us and them is the Industrial Revolution and a load of other technological advancements. And a lot of what this has meant for us is that for much of the world, it has separated physical exertion from our survival. And yet, we still need physical exertion to be healthy. So we're now adding it back in intentionally. As counterintuitive as the wording may sound, we have actually added in some intentional inefficiency so that we can put back into our lives an element that we technologically evolved past. Not many of us still have to physically exert ourselves like we might have had to centuries ago in order to survive. So to stay healthy, we now add that back in. I believe we're actually in another, at the risk of sounding overly dramatic, revolutionary time. A time that is changing how we live, presenting us with new challenges, opening up new opportunities, and it's also ushering in the need to focus very intentionally on some things that we may have taken for granted. I think one of those things that needs a little more focus now is empathy. Empathy is one of those terms that has a lot of definitions. So for simplicity's sake, I'm going to go with a very simple definition, and that is simply this. Empathy is the ability to be moved by the feelings of other people. Just a few years ago, researchers from the University of Michigan found that empathy had decreased by about 40% in college students since the year 2000. That's a pretty significant drop, and I think most of us would agree that there is a detectable decline in empathy in a lot of society around us. Maybe now really is the time to start empathetic gyms. Just imagine a place where you can go and work out, where you can do two laps of caring about my problems, where some sort of empathy fitness instructor can yell at you to drop and give them 50 reps of compassion. It's just a thought. You know, incidentally, research from the University of Cambridge shows that empathetic ability is actually only about 10% genetic. 90% of it can be taught and learned. Really, there's no excuse for not getting in empathetic shape. I think empathy is tied very closely in with interdependence. And I think interdependence is one of the things we're trying to reduce through technology. We can just do so much on our own and individually now. Online banking and shopping means that we don't have to interact interpersonally quite as much as we used to. And then social media gives us unprecedented power to decide what we share, how we share it, what we hear. We can now craft our entire personal persona and decide how we want to be perceived. We also get to decide what we even allow in for us to perceive. The danger is a well-crafted post can give us the feeling of being heard and understood, even if we're not actually heard and understood. All in all, we have less need to actually interact with other people. But I think that in much the same way that physical exertion is important for our health, I think interdependence is really important for our overall well-being. And the more we go without it, the more I think we're going to have to find creative ways to intentionally add interdependence back in. In fact, I think our newfound ability to separate out interdependence from our survival is actually one of the reasons that more and more people in our world are feeling alone, divided, and disconnected, despite the fact that we actually have, thanks to technology, more ability to unite, more ability to connect than we ever really have before. Even before the global pandemic, which, believe me, as somebody who travels a lot, has definitely left me feeling isolated. But even the global pandemic has actually helped showcase how creativity and ingenuity can help us overcome factors that disconnect us. This event is full of brilliant examples showcasing that. But on a broader scale, many people were feeling lonely and disconnected before the pandemic. Ohio State University released a study that showed that we respond to loneliness as if it were physical stress. It actually weakens our immune system and causes physical inflammation in us. And back in 2015, Time magazine ran a story entitled "Why Loneliness May Be the Next Big Public Health Issue." In the UK, the Mental Health Foundation ran a study that found that more than half the population felt that we were generally getting lonelier. And in the United States, there has been a threefold increase in the number of people who say that they have no close confidants. The pandemic has brought to the forefront something that has been building for a while. And here's where I think you come in, because remember, I said we were going to talk about you for a little bit. So let's start with your kids, shall we? If you have a family, there's a chance that your kids might be what we call third culture kids. If you don't have a family, there's a chance you may know some third culture kids. In fact, there's a chance you may have grown up as a third culture kid. So let's look into what exactly that is. Very briefly, in an oversimplified form, a third culture kid is simply someone who's grown up, and during their developmental years, they've spent a lot of time with multiple cultural influences in a high degree of transition. Now, it's important to realize TCKs don't necessarily have to travel a ton to be TCKs. There are loads of parts of the world now where you can stay put and multiple cultural influences and a load of transition will come to you. Now, maybe you're a third culture adult. Maybe you came from a more monocultural upbringing, but then as an adult moved into a lifestyle that brought multiple cultural influences and a fair amount of transition. If so, you probably share a lot of traits with third culture kids. And third culture kids are interesting. And I don't just say that because I am one. Nope, I say that because lots of research says so. In fact, one of my favorite quotes comes from a sociologist named Ted Ward, who in the 1980s said, "TCKs are prototype citizens of the future." I think that's true, except that I think the future is actually now. Incidentally, TCKs have been studied for about 70 years, and we've learned a lot about them. And in many ways, what we've been doing is studying little previews of coming attractions. The truth is that the skills third culture kids pick up by growing up with cross-cultural exposure and transience are the skills that we now all need. And the challenges that third culture kids face are now the challenges all of us face. I'll use conflict resolution as a simple example. Many third culture kids struggle with conflict resolution because if you grow up in transience, you can just make relationships disposable. If you get in a fight with someone, you don't have to fix it. If you just wait a little while, they'll move or you'll likely move, so you can just avoid things, which is actually really unhealthy to become an adult and only know how to avoid conflict. Well, that's crept into mainstream culture now, too. It used to be just something we worried about with third culture kids, but now it's something we all need to pay attention to. Social media has meant that all of us can actually make relationships disposable. If you get in a bad enough argument or fight with someone, you can just delete them. And so now everybody is dealing with conflict resolution as something that needs more attention. Identity is another area that third culture kids often find difficult. Can you be both a global citizen and have a strong national identity? And as a third culture kid, does that strong national identity come from the country that issued your passport or the country or countries where you've spent the most time? Now globalization is making identity more complex and difficult for everybody. In fact, oftentimes the ideas of globalization present seemingly opposing concepts all together at once. We want to simultaneously take down borders and barriers to international trade and commerce, while also buying locally as much as humanly possible. We want to protect localized cultures and traditions, while also presenting far more of a united global front. It can be a tall order to try to work out the complexities of this sort of identity. We've also noticed amongst TCKs, and actually by extension, third culture adults and all kinds of expats, the incredible need for adaptability. Which sounds really, really obvious. If you're going to function cross-culturally, you're going to have to be adaptable. But that part of the concept actually takes us back to empathy. Adaptation requires observation. You have to be able to take in information in order to figure out how to act and speak and move and function in different cultural settings and circumstances. And that ability to observe and take action actually flexes our empathetic muscles. There's a project called Greater Good, which was put together by the University of Berkeley in California, and they published a list of traits for what they called highly empathetic people. And that list, even though it has absolutely nothing to do with relocation or transition or a cross-cultural move, looks like something that would come straight out of an HR manual or a relocation seminar or the welcome package for an international school. Basically, what this means is this is where we come in again. We have the incredible opportunity to hone our empathetic skills because of our circumstances. Transition, change management, observation, these are all skills tied to empathy, something the world really needs right now. We have a truly phenomenal wealth of talent and knowledge and skills and passion spread out across the globe as part of this network of third culture kids, of parents and spouses and partners, educators, globally mobile professionals, expats, and those who work with them. Not to mention local communities who are taking on the challenges of an increasingly globalized world every day. You don't have to go very far for multiple cultures to come to you. Transition is something all of us have to deal with more and more. The pandemic has created a situation where basically the entire planet has been sent on assignment to a completely different situation, and it's having to learn and adapt. Much like many expats and people in the globally mobile arena have had to do repeatedly, just on a much, much bigger scale. And the beautiful thing is, amidst all of this, there is hope. And this is where you come in yet again. As many of the talented presenters during this event have pointed out, we are capable of finding tools and resources, not just to get through the circumstances we find ourselves in, but to actually excel, learn from, and thrive. And that is a phenomenal thing that the world needs, because the reality is the world is moving closer and closer to a globally mobile experience, even during a pandemic. We as a community have a tremendous opportunity to be bridge builders and bringers of hope. The empathetic skills that we get to hone are things that the whole world needs now in a place where empathy is on the decline. The ability to adapt, to observe, to take on multiple perspectives, those aren't skills that just we need anymore. They're skills that everybody needs, and we need to be spreading them and demonstrating them as widely as possible. And we can find plenty of practical and innovative ways to do that. There are several projects like the Think Global People and Future Fit initiatives that have been mentioned at this conference. There's also other projects like What Expats Can Do. There are tons of ways that we can help spread what we have been able to take on to a world that really is moving closer and closer to our experience. I'm going to leave you with one last story, mostly because it's fun to tell stories, but also because I think it's applicable for what we need to do. For the story to make sense, you need to know that I'm incredibly sensitive to heat. I sweat profusely. And I don't mean that in a sweat how everyone sweats kind of way. I mean I sweat very three-dimensionally. Sweat leaps off of my body at people. So overheating is a big deal to me. This story takes place initially in Zagreb, Croatia, where a friend of mine named Walter, who very kindly comes on a lot of diabolical schemes that I come up with, had joined me for some trips and adventures. We were actually on our way home and taking a train from Zagreb, Croatia to Budapest, Hungary. It was the height of summer, and as we approached our waiting train, I realized the train wasn't parked in the station under the shade. The train had been left outside without any sort of covering. And so when we opened the door to get inside, a burst of hot air came out and melted all my hair away. That's actually how I became bald. We got on board the train and found an empty compartment, which was very convenient. We sat down and waited for us to start moving. All the while, I was sweating profusely. Puddles of my sweat were beginning to collect on the floor. Walter grew concerned that if nothing was done and the heat was not lowered, I may actually fill up our entire compartment with my sweat and drown us. We thought that once the train started moving, surely the air conditioning would come on. The train eventually did start moving, and no air conditioning came on. In fact, what came out of the vents was far more like someone standing uncomfortably close behind you and breathing on your neck. The train was basically saying to us, which is not comforting at all. I began to panic. I thought, well, I'll just open the window. That'll let some cool air in. I won't drown us. Everything will be fine. The windows were bolted shut. I thought, we're not staying in this compartment, not with bolty windows. No. So we moved on to another compartment. Its windows were also bolted. We tried the windows in the gangway, all bolted. Every window on this train was bolted. Now, the ride from Zagreb, Croatia to Budapest, Hungary was at least 10 hours. I could produce a lot of sweat in 10 hours. It wasn't going to be good for anyone. I began to panic, and I began to get irrational. I thought, I'll just go and open the emergency exit door at the end. I can hang out at the end of the train, and that'll keep me cool, and I might look triumphant as well. Walter worried a little that I might fall to my death, which was reasonable. And so thankfully, before I had a chance to try out this weird plan, Walter noticed that on his keychain was a key that happened to be exactly the same width as that of the groove in the bolts that were holding the windows closed. So Walter was able to use a key to unbolt the windows in our compartment. We got the windows open, a breeze came in, my sweat began to evaporate, and everything was going to be fine. And as we sat there, reveling in the cool air that was now going to keep us alive, I had a thought. And I said, Walter, every window on this train is bolted. He said, yes. I said, Walter, that means everyone else on this train is also slowly being cooked. And he said, yes. I said, well, Walter, we have to do something. Walter said, we probably should, but what? I said, well, we'll just go and open everyone's windows. Walter got nervous because he realized and pointed out that neither he nor I speak Croatian or Hungarian. And I said, we're going to do it anyway. This is going to be the Great Croatian Train Liberation, because things are more fun if you give them a big title. Walter was so nervous, he didn't want to come with me. He felt it would be intrusive. So I took Walter's keys and I left him in the compartment and I moved to one end of the train and I started the very first compartment that I found. In it was a very sad and sorry sight. Six people were slowly melting into one big pile of human soup, and I took it upon myself to do what I could to help. I flung the door open, jumped inside, which got a lot of sweat on my legs, and said, don't worry, I'm here to liberate you. I'm going to open your windows. And so I moved through the sweaty mass, and I unbolted the windows, and in came a lovely breeze, and six people began to revive, and all said, actually, I don't know what they said, because I still don't speak Croatian. But it looked exciting, so I moved on to the next compartment and repeated the whole thing. Opened the windows, people revived, don't know what anyone said, but they seemed happy. By about the fourth or fifth compartment, I flung the door open and said, don't worry, I'm here to liberate you, and got a response. It turns out the people in this compartment spoke French, and as well we know, the French motto is Egalite, Fraternite, Liberté. So when I said I'm here to liberate you, they recognized the Fraternite, the Egalite, and the Liberté. And so I said to them in terrible French, because I speak terrible French, I'm going to ouvre your fenêtres. So I opened the windows, a breeze came in, they revived, and I said, de rien, c'est pas grave, no problem, no. And I was about to move on, and I noticed that they were coming with me. I moved into the gangway, and six French people followed me. I opened the next door, and before I could say anything to the next compartment, six French people yelled, Fraternité, Égalité, Liberté! And I said, oh no, we're going to scare people. I moved in, I opened the windows, a breeze came in, and I moved on, and six French people came with me, and then six more people from that compartment came with me. I went to open a door, and now a dozen people all yelled, Liberté! This continued on. The more compartments I opened the windows in, the more people that came along. It got to the point where people heard us coming and were worried that they were being robbed. I'd throw open a door, a whole bunch of people would scream, Liberté, and people would just hold up money and wallets. When he said, no, 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 we're not here to rob you. We're going to over here for natural. We're going to open your window. It's going to be fine. We made it clear through to the end of the train. Everybody was finally free of the oppressive heat. And I suddenly worried and thought, whoa, I've abandoned Walter. So I went back and I couldn't find him anywhere. Turns out Walter had heard the angry masses and was frantically looking for me. Walter was very worried that the train was under attack and that we needed to get out of there. I calmed Walter down and introduced him to the new crowd and said, everyone, this is Walter. Walter's key liberated us from the heat of this train. And everybody yelled, Viva Walter, which I think is phenomenal. Now, the great thing about this experience is that it doesn't actually end there. Everyone was getting along so well and felt so proud to be together that they didn't want to stop. And so when the train did finally arrive in Budapest, about 60 or 70 people all got off together and wanted to go to dinner together, which is a little threatening to small cafes. And the beautiful thing was the interdependence that this fostered, because there were a load of people who'd never been to the city before, and other people suddenly were willing to help show them around. There were people who didn't have a place to stay yet, and other people helped them find places to stay. The mood was so inclusive that we actually started a Facebook group. There is now the Great Croatian Train Liberation Facebook group. We've actually been to members' weddings in the past couple of years. I tell you this story because I very legitimately think that this is our story. I think that we're all on a journey together, and I think there are things that we can do to help each other out. We need to be bold enough to recognize the tools at our disposal and to use them. And as a result, we get to go back and build in some of the interdependence that we so desperately need now, even when technology is doing its best to move us on from it. My friends, we have some figurative trains to liberate, and possibly even some literal ones, who knows? What I do know is that I really believe we've been given some tools and skills that can help in this endeavor. I want to leave you with one last quote. It's from a book called Velvet Elvis by Rob Bell, and the quote sums up what I want to leave us with, as there are so many adventures ahead of us. And the quote says this, "Ultimately, our gift to the world around us is hope. And it's not a blind hope that pretends everything is fine and refuses to acknowledge how things really are, but it's the kind of hope that comes from staring pain and suffering right in the eyes and refuses to believe that's all there is." My friends, it is such an honor to get to be here with you virtually. Thank you for all that you continue to bring to a world moving closer and closer to your experience. Hurrah for the adventures still to come.